you very much. Thank you, Song, for this generous introduction. Thank you, all of you, for coming here and accompanying us for this first session. I would like to express, in the first place, my deep gratitude to the persons who kindly invited me to present today in front of you this keynote speech. And in particular, I would like to mention Yeon-Soo Kim, my colleague and friend of many years, almost a lifetime, whom I admire both personally and intellectually. I would like also to thank Yoon-Ji Park for your wonderful invitation as well and your help throughout the process. And I would like to thank my friend Song No. 감사합니다, as we say normally in Korean. Yeon-Soo and Song, professors and above all friends, know me well and also know that I enjoy a certain degree of intellectual provocation. What happened, I am going to start with just a very short anecdote, is that I was writing this keynote speech on my almost brand new computer when, oh, sadness, the computer decided to die of a very sudden and sad death. It was a very terrible moment. Also because I was like this. I was about to write the next word, and that the next word never came. Because instead of those words, just the screen became. Of course, I lost everything. That was 3 days ago. So I had to rewrite everything. In a certain way, this provocation, which is not very provocative as a matter of fact, is also led in this case by my anger against computership, computers and technology in general. No, no, believe me, it's not. But nowhere, I think, is intellectual and academic provocation more adequate than in the middle of a keynote speech. Indeed, a keynote speech is supposed to state and stage a note, or in musical terms, a tonality, or the point of departure of other scales, the audible instant from which other notes arise with the different purposes of following the melody, creating harmonies, counterpoints, dissonances, and so on. So, do not take my note as a thesis to agree with, but rather as ideas to be countered, as thesis for debate. In the end, you must know, I am but a simple philologist with a very traditional training in two very traditional academic milieus, Spain and France, where I studied and worked for 10 years of my life, before moving to the US. Furthermore, of all traditional philologists, I am perhaps among the most traditional group, that of the medievalists. Likewise, I am attached to very traditional philological methodologies and ways to approach philological issues and philological objects of study. I pay attention to language, to discourse, to material objects, mainly manuscript form, etc. So in a word, my daily life as a philologist is mostly boring. Not that it does not interest me. It is simply tedious, or a labor that, as Michel Foucault put it, est grise. Elle est méticuleuse et patiemment documentaire. Elle travaille sur des parchemins brouillés, grattés, plusieurs fois écrits. A gray, meticulous and patiently documentary, it operates on a field of entangled and confused parchments, on documents that have been scratched over and recopied many times. These are, at the same time, the traditions that I have been willing to shake away from me. I acknowledge that philological methods and the very technical language of philosophy are also the remnants of colonialism, of specific forms of state-nation, of religion and theological power, of master narratives in history, of legalization of trends, forms of expression, and manners of looking at language that have sacralized and normalized patriarchal discourses, colonial power, and forms of oppression, including slavery. I am not the one stating this. In his Scienza Nuova, the 18th century Jesuit intellectual Giambattista Vico, whom Isaiah Berlin considered in the margins of enlightenment, one of the critics of enlightenment, he says. And Vico was also partially a subject of the Iberian Kingdom, as he had lived most of his life under Bourbon rule in Naples. He understood the necessity to found, he said, a new science with specific lines of inquiry that he was eager to lay down. He thought that philosophy, which was, according to him, the science of truth, had set itself an almost impossible task, and that one needed to move towards a coscienza del certo, a consciousness of certainty, rather than a science of truth. This consciousness of certainty. Now, in order to study this consciousness of certainty, philosophy was an inadequate science. One needed to investigate, he said, human decisions, religion, the state, political, legal, and rhetorical arguments, among other things, and the right science for this purpose was indeed philology. The history of philology is a political and legal history. It cannot be disentangled from the legal systems and the states for which philological claims and philological arguments constituted, in fact, arguments of legitimization. This history cannot and should not be erased, but it is our task to submit it to criticism. One, however, bears the mark of philological methods, philological inquiry, and philological goals in an indelible form. Because I'm aware of that, I feel also like that person who got a tattoo during a party blurred in the memory and has spent the rest of his life from his adolescence to get rid of it to no avail. You may think that I am talking about myself, but I am not just talking about myself. I'm talking about the inscription of forms of humanism in many academies around the world, and in particular in the Western Hemisphere. I wonder sometimes whether technology and what we normally call the digital humanities is one of the forms of perpetuation of that inscription. I think I know why universities and other institutions, including funding agencies, both private and public, are eager to foster the field of digital humanities. It gives them a purpose and provides them with a reliable technical language for a field of study in the humanities that can be thus quantified, analyzed, and submitted to metrics. Unlike the product of a deconstructionist or a new historicist, the product of a digital humanist can be measured, contained, and described. It can be used. Let me just read a very beautiful passage of Augustine of Hippo's De Doctrina Christiana, on Christian doctrine, that I'm not going to read in Latin. You're welcome. To enjoy a thing, he says, is to rest with satisfaction in it for its own sake. To use, on the other hand, is to employ whatever means are at one's disposal to obtain what one desires. If it is a proper object of desire, for an unlawful use ought rather to be called an abuse. Suppose then we were wanderers in a strange country and could not live happily away from our fatherland, and that we felt wretched in our wandering and wishing to put an end to our misery, determined to return home. We find, however, that we must make use of some mode of conveyance, either by land or water, in order to reach that fatherland where our enjoyment is to commence. But the beauty of the country through which we pass, Korea, let's say. And the very pleasure of emotion, charm of our hearts, and turning these things which we ought to use into objects of enjoyment, we become unwilling to hasten the end of our journey, and becoming engrossed in a factitious delight, our thoughts are diverted from that home whose delights would make us truly happy. Such is a picture of our condition in this life of mortality, and because we all have to die, as we knew before. We have wandered from far from God, he says, and if we wish to return to our Father's home, this world must be used, not enjoyed, that so the invisible things of God may be clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, that is, by means of what is material and temporary, we may lay hold upon that which is spiritual and eternal. The passage would take centuries to unpack, but I would simply like to underscore the preeminence of usage, which is based on a specific teleology, obtaining a lawful goal that provides us with a more universal knowledge, spiritual and eternal. Things on the way are, as Augustine says, visible signs that indicate the path of the invisible. Use, not enjoy. This is what I meant before when I said that the digital humanities as a perpetuation of philological traditions and methods can be used and therefore pacify a little the anxieties of the institutions of higher education and the foundations that work with them as satellites. Again, digital humanistic projects provide the humanities with specific purposes and laboriously established teleologies. They provide peace in the world that we have come to call the crisis of the humanities. Who could reject peace? In France or in Spain, the discipline we call philology is well and alive. I have been professor of philology, Romance philology, for 10 years of my life in the University of Salamanca, if you can believe that. So, in France, the departments avoided the word philology as the academia was well attached to the denomination of lettres. In Spain, there were some movements to reform the curriculum, and in some universities it was expected that a new licenciatura, or major in the humanities, would replace the various philologies, although, of course, some of the decisions in this sense ended up backfiring prodigiously, as it was the case in the University of Salamanca. Philology, even during those turbulent years of crisis and metrics, produced specific results that could be quantified and then used to categorize the professors, establish rankings, and of course collect resources. I'm not saying that this was the only purpose, but it was a visible one, and one that tapped into the new obsession of many universities in the pre- and post-Bologna era to become relevant again. Could philology be relevant? Had it ever been? Was it enough to claim its pacifying effects of keeping alive a certain tradition, and in particular a certain Western tradition that helped build the monument we call Europe? Those were also the times when Manlio Bellomo wrote The Common Legal Past of Europe, Italo Calvino wrote Why Read the Classics, and so many others wrote about what was the common culture of Europe. In my current university, Columbia University, peace has always been obtained by means of what we call the core curriculum. This is the set of courses that all students, regardless of the major they intend to pursue, must complete. They include literature, music, sciences, or what we call contemporary civilization, which also includes, of course, Ibn Rushd and many other contemporary thinkers, Augustine of Hippo, and you know, all those contemporary thinkers from the Middle Ages. That was a joke. you can laugh. All students at Columbia will have read a list of authors, mostly from the Western canon, mostly white males. The list has undergone many changes, especially since Edward Said, one of the most distinguished professors that Columbia has ever had, engaged with this list from the perspective of a Palestinian thinker. Like him, other scholars and professors have suggested and accomplished ways to transform the core without really transforming it. My dear and admired colleague Gayatri Spivak has probably been the most vocal about the opportunity of those transformations, and so have been other professors like Julie Crawford or Sharon Marcus. The list has been kept, but has also become more inclusive, more interconnected, more intersectional. That's the one I that is perhaps lacking or missing in this triple I theme of this conference. More intersectional, keeping pace while shaking up some very solid foundations. The formation of the field in the digital humanities has been instrumental. It will be instrumental for this kind of peacemaking. It does have the advantages of producing knowledge by building things. I will simply call them things, but we can be more precise later. Reproducing and renewing the traditional methods, making coexist the canon with what exists without the canon, and even foster forms of activism. The work of Adeline Coe, who left academia a few years ago to become the CEO of the beauty product company. The work of Adeline Coe, Rupsi Rizam, Alex Hill, or Dorothy Kim are good examples of this kind of work. Alex Hill's editions of Aimé Césaire are a philological production born digital, and Coe and Rizam have produced important work in postcolonial digital humanities. The intervention of Dorothy Kim from Vassar College in race and white supremacy in medievalism not only foster scholarly research but also political action. At Columbia, again, the work of historian and director of the Center for Science and Society, Pamela Smith, and her Making and Knowing project has transformed the perspective on modern humanities and modern social sciences by means of digital interventions. These digital interventions require our attention. They are the ones that are in our hands and in the hands of our funding institutions nowadays. I want to mention the names and transforming projects of Domenico Fiormonte and many others who are currently engaging with a less Eurocentric, more inclusive version of the humanities by looking for new projects outside the more canonical languages and traditions. They are looking at Asia, at Africa, and Latin America in search for a renovation of the humanities in digital form. A few days ago, Eric Weisskott wrote a very smart article for the Chronicle of Higher Education in which he claimed that, and that's the title of the article, there is no such thing as the digital humanities. This is a tremendously commonsensical article in response to Timothy Brennan's article published in the same journal. Brennan engaged in a critique of the digital humanities, arguing that the accomplishments of an overfunded and hyped field fell short on its promises after 10 years of development in higher education institutions and the surrounding funding agencies. Weisskott denied the major premise that there is such thing as the digital humanities, and Weisskott indeed replaces this expression of a proper name or a field with a different one, simply digital humanities, a common name, just a mere denomination of descriptive character rather than prescriptive. These are some of Weisskott's elegant words. The problem with the formulation the digital humanities, he says, is that it equates a new institutional investment with a new form of knowledge. Institutional investments and forms of knowledge are related, but you can have one without the other. As, he says, any independent scholar or any director of a center for some new combination of disciplines will tell you. And a bit further down, he says, what digital humanities skeptics really object to is that colleges and universities are co-opting digitized research and teaching for ostensibly nefarious purposes. Brennan, the author he is struggling with or fighting against, worries that the digital humanities do that what the digital humanities do is create a framework for lucrative tech deals in classrooms with the promise of the vast automatization of teaching. Laying that criticism at the feet of researchers who use digital techniques within their disciplines isn't just unfair, he says. It's a category mistake. And then he concludes, the problem with lucrative tech deals is the lucre, not tech. As I said, these are extremely commonsensical considerations, and it is difficult to disagree with them. As he puts it throughout the article, questioning the digital humanities would be like questioning a field called printed humanities that would have started with Gutenberg and his ilk, and that would have been criticized in depth by those defenders of the manuscript as a conveyor of culture in general. Naturally, what Weiskott considers as a boutade, or something said in jest, is also true. The printing press was heavily attacked as a devilish invention and as an instrument that introduced all sorts of hybridity in the production and dissemination of culture, and whose permanence and archivability, its ability to transmit authoritative texts in an authoritative way, was questioned an incredible amount of times. If you think of it, bureaucracies around the globe still rely on the manuscript rely better on the manuscript than in printed materials, with the purpose of curbing forgery. So the joke is really not such a joke. Furthermore, the analogy between printed humanities and digital humanities really doesn't work. The printing press strives to make more copies of the things people were already required to read. It is not a coincidence that the first book to be printed was the Bible, or that the first book printed in Spain, for instance, was the regulation resulting from a synod. It is not a coincidence that most printed books from the early period were of a professional character, and that they were supposed to convey exact copies of an exemplar, although whomever has seen copies of the same edition of any printed book knows this goal was not achieved at all, in order to avoid errors and forgery. They were devised as the ultimate product of diplomatic sincerity, if not uncontested truth. In front of that, digital projects are aware of their ability to be in transit, of their capacity to include many different hands and minds working together from very remote locations, of their options to transform the cognitive conditions in which one reads, edits, discusses, and so on. But Weiskott's argument is flawed in other aspects as well, even if he ultimately is right, which I really don't know. The first argument is that you can separate, he says, institutional investments from forms of knowledge, and he says that any independent scholar or founder of a new interdisciplinary center will let you know that this is true, but I doubt he asked them. The second argument is that whenever tech and lucrative purposes become entangled inextricably, the blame must be put on the lucrative side, not on the technological one. The truth of the matter, and that's, of course, my perspective, is that in the current situation, you cannot separate institutional investment in forms of knowledge. What any independent scholar will tell you is how extraordinarily difficult it is to engage in some form of non-traditional or groundbreaking research without other funding, given that external funding, if one is not independently wealthy, comes earmarked for specific purposes and even specific projects, rather than a general context for the best possible project. What a director of a new center will let you know, and that I know it firsthand, what a director of a new center will let you know is that they do not have institutional funding, but if you press this director, she or he will tell you that the very creation of the center involves an investment, the mobilization of personnel, the movements of fundraising and other activities that require the formation of the center within the institution. So, no, there is no way to separate both. As for the second argument, if there is an affinity in the Weberian sense of the concept between technology and lucrative purposes as we see it every day in our universities, the blame cannot fall only on the lucrative side, but rather in the ways in which such affinity has been established. In this sense, it is adequate to ask a difficult question: what is the role of the higher education institution and the funding agencies in the construction of an affinity between technologies applied to the humanities and lucrative purposes? How does the institution negotiate the value of the technological humanistic endeavors? The most obvious thesis, a response to these questions, is that institutions and funding agencies have perfectly understood that the technological turn in the humanities, a turn that is essentially different from the printing press revolution, involves a process of STEMization of the humanities, or a movement to pass the humanities as sciences or engineering. This movement opens up, as I said before, the possibility of measuring goals and achievements in a quantitative form, as many of the products of the digital humanities can be described and presented as data sets. Measuring in this case, or setting in motion specific metrics of success, evacuate some of the most ubiquitous elements of the humanities and the social sciences, namely the politicization of the disciplines that compose the humanities and the social sciences, and that bother to no end a corporate model of the institutions of higher education that rely on donors and external funding. Metrics and analytics are one of the ways in which the institutions of higher education yields to neoliberal trends, and it is also one of the ways in which academic diversity, academic freedom, and intellectual freedom are technically curtailed. It would be long to explain the strategies for curtailing those basic liberties of academic, scholarly, and intellectual work. I am currently conducting a series of interviews about academic and intellectual freedom. I am interviewing scholars and intellectuals from many different disciplines around the globe, and I have endless hours of taped conversations with therapists, artists, editors, architects, philosophers, and other scholars. What is more frightening is the many ways in which forms of regulating academic freedom are becoming normalized and accepted with time, ingrained in the very bureaucracy of the institution and indeed of our societies. Technology, the emergence of the expository society that Bernard Harcourt has studied in depth, and the counter-revolutionary mode of legality around the globe, and in particular in neoliberal globalized societies, have played an extraordinarily important role in this regulation and finally transformation of a principle of academic freedom that has been central to some of our societies since at least Spinoza. But as I said, I do not blame technology. What I blame is the construction of the affinities between technology and those social, academic, and intellectual transformations, an affinity that our institutions, in the name of technological advancement, have contributed to create, thus increasing the vulnerability of many individuals across the globe. The affinity between technology and the humanities, and this is what is different between the printing press turn and the technological turn, has sacralized distance. It has established a cordon sanitaire, separating the bodily interaction from the object itself. The idea behind distant reading, as imagined by Franco Moretti, was originally, as he himself confesses, a joke, an afterthought. But Moretti also says, nobody seemed to get the joke, and they took literally, as the possibility to ask a machine to read on your behalf thousands of novels, a task that one single person would be unable to do during a lifetime. Distance, for Moretti, implied critical distance, a certain degree of separation from the modes of reading we were used to, that is, close reading and contextual reading. He proposed a form of distance that would ask simple questions to large corpora, not with the intent to read them in a literal sense, but with the purpose of identifying the distribution of the answers to those simple questions. My suggestion is that we do strive to foster closeness. The first step for this is that we ourselves get closer to the objects we study, that we understand their own characteristics as artifacts that are central to specific performances, that the scale of the thing we study is nothing else than a micro scale. A micro scale in this case means fundamentally to understand time. Another quite important text from Augustine of Hippo comes from book 11 of his Confessions. Those of you who have read it may remember it vividly, as it is vividly written. Bear with me, for the passage is a little bit long to move from place to place if I could not measure the time in which it moves. But if so, what do I use to measure time with? Do we measure a longer time by a shorter one, as we measure a beam in terms of cubits? We all do that. Thus, we say that the duration of a long syllable is measured by the space of a short syllable, and it's said to be double. Thus, we measure the length of poems by the lengths of the lines, and the lengths of the lines by the lengths of the feet, and the lengths of the feet by the syllables, and the lengths of the syllables by the lengths of short. We do not measure poems by pages, for that would measure space, not time. We measure by the way the voice moves in uttering the poem. But not by all this we arrive at an exact measure of time. It may well happen that a shorter line may take longer if it is recited slowly than a longer line hurried through. And the same is true of a poem, or a foot, or a syllable. The things we study are the very phenomenology of time. Augustine finds in the poem, in the linguistic utterance, and in the body that utters it, the measure of time. It does not matter that we cannot define time, if we can articulate the ways in which time is measured and inscribed in the objects we study, as they themselves are instruments to measure time. The most direct way to do it, to measure time, to inscribe time, to work at this microscale, would be what my friend and colleague Dennis Tennant did with a corpus of 19th century novels, create a small program that would identify the ways in which narrative texts record time. But I wonder whether the conclusions were in a certain way predictable. In his two-volume book, Temps et Récits, Paul Ricoeur already explained the radically different experience of time within the narrative and how it struggled with real time. You've probably read Julio Cortázar's Las Armas Secretas, in one of whose chapters Charlie Parker wonders how is it possible for him to have thought things that in real time had lasted several hours in the minimal space of two metro stations in Paris. And we know that metro stations in Paris are really close to each other. This is the kind of struggle studied by Ricoeur, the opposing, competing, and sometimes enemy phenomenologies of time that happen whenever we engage in any sort of narrative, be it literary or not. The question here is not how medieval manuscripts, for instance, register time, rather how they force time on the bodies. Or in other words, how is it time measured with those manuscripts? Let me give a very obvious example. Ramon Llull's Llibre d'Amic et d'Amat, the book of the lover and the beloved, is one of the parts of the Llibre de Basti Blanquerna, the book of Basti and Blanquerna, a long narrative that encompasses the life of Blanquerna, from his birth as a son of Evast and Aroma, his process of education in the art, which I will explain in a bit, to the adulthood of Blanquerna, his steps towards the highest hierarchy of the Catholic Church, indeed he is elected Pope, and finally his abdication from his papal position to become a hermit, evoking or echoing the story of Celestine V, the Pope who abdicated. Not that of Benedict XVI who abdicated, but still that. Here we have, in fact, three intersecting bodies of narrative. The biography of Blanquerna, the narrative of the art itself, which is the science devised by Ramon Llull to find the truth by means of a machine of thinking based on combinations and spinning wheels on manuscript created by Llull himself. And finally, the narrative body of the Libre d'Amic et d'Amat, the book of the lover and the beloved. Now, the Libre d'Amic et d'Amat is a body of narrative that opposes its own time, not only to the rest of the book, but more specifically to the reader, to those of us who engage with it. It requires from us to measure time in a different way because it is composed of 365 of tweetable thoughts, one per day of the year. One needs to guess that leap years spend one whole day with no reading at all or something like that. When we get to the Libra d'Amic et d'Amat, we are forced into measuring time in a loop forever, according to a style of thinking that, as Lyul claims, comes from the Sufi world. One needs to read the thought for the particular day one is reading, and then meditate on it. If we were to read it in our real time, the Libra would last just the time of emptying out a teapot. Materially, we can do it, but intellectually, can we? If we get physically very close to the Libra, to this book, and read it, we will consume it immediately and can go ahead for the next next text. But then we cannot do what the text is asking us to do, which is to meditate, to reflect on it, without giving us any other hint, any other idea of how to do that. The challenge of the digital humanities is not doing distant things. It is achieving closeness. Distance has a desensitizing power that we people who work in the humanities cannot afford to miss. Every single technological document must be a document of closeness that deploys rather than hides the order of affects. Reproducing a text by means of digital edition, creating a map, or setting up any other tool require these kinds of closeness. We cannot give in to the institutions who have played and who are playing in the last few years with distance, with massive online courses, and with funding only and exclusive or preferentially these kinds of technological endeavors. Because institutions also, and specifically for the humanities, are playing with desensitization, with removing us from the order of affects. And this is one of the names of the crisis in the humanities.